will exactly function in the same way. It will replicate the functionality of your rigid body. Okay, so that is the concept of dynamically equivalent system, where I replace a continuously distributed mass rigid body with two point masses that are separated by some particular distance, which is going to resemble your continuous mass body exactly under dynamic loading condition. Okay, that is the entire concept of dynamically equivalent system. Okay, so there are three rules for doing this. When do you call two mass equivalent system and a rigid body to be equivalent, dynamically equivalent? Okay, please underline the word dynamically equivalent. They will behave exactly in the same way as a continuous rigid body will do. These two point mass systems separated by a distance, when there are three rules for that. First point, sum of their masses is equal to the total mass of the body. These two point masses separated by a distance, when I add these two masses, m1 plus m2, should be equal to the mass of the rigid body, which I am replacing. So m1 plus m2 equal to m. Very simple rule, first rule. Second rule, the center of gravity of the two masses coincide with that of the body. So when you bring two different point masses into the system, you should have an effective center of gravity for both the masses. Each will have its own individual center of gravity. Now you are placing them between two distance, like physical balance, right? You put some vegetables on the left pan and some mass on the right pan. Now you lift the balance. The resultant difference will always determine the position of your horizontal scale. When the horizontal scale is exactly horizontal, when you are connecting beam which holds the two pans are horizontal, it means they are equal. Okay, similarly, there is an effective center of gravity for these two bodies. That effective center of gravity should lie in such a position that it is exactly coinciding with the center of gravity of the rigid body, previous rigid body. If I overlap the newly developed equivalent system with that old continuous rigid body, the center of gravity should coincide at the single point. How do you do that? That is done by adjusting the distance between the two masses. Okay, the formulas will take care of that. By adjusting the distance between the two masses, I am going to make sure that the center of gravity point is not going to change. Only then my dynamic equivalence is possible. Dynamic first two points. Third point, sum of the mass moment of inertia of the masses above their center of gravity is equal to the mass moment of inertia of the rigid body, I equal to mk square. Okay, so that is a formula for moment of inertia for a rotating object. So don't worry about the moment of inertia that you have found out in mechanics. Forget that. Here mass moment of inertia means I equal to mk square in dynamics, because moment of inertia, you are studying moment of inertia of a moving body. Okay, body in motion. So we care only about mk square. Okay, so these individual bodies, now this center of gravity here, it is mentioned here, okay, the mass moment of inertia of the masses about their center of gravity. This is the individual center of gravity, not the cumulative center of gravity. Okay, so each body will have its own center of gravity, these point masses. Now I'm going to find out the I equal to mk square about that center of gravity. Why do we need center of gravity to find the moment of inertia? Mk square. What is k? Radius of gyration. What is the distance from the center of rotation to the minimum non-negligible amount of mass? That radius is called radius of gyration. Now that you have to calculate from the center of gravity of that particular object, not from the cumulative center of gravity. Okay, don't worry if you are unable to understand this 100%. It is not very difficult. You need some imagination to understand this. Okay, so some of the mass moment of inertia, I am going to find out two moment of inertia of the two point masses individually about their individual center of gravities, and I am going to find I1 mk1 square plus I2 mk2 square. Now this should be equal to I equal to mk square of the rigid body, which you have replaced with these two masses. These are the three rules. Okay, so when the above mentioned three conditions are met, then the systems are said to be dynamically equivalent. Okay, now let us see mathematically how these things are done. Considering a rigid body how having its center of gravity at g, as shown here, I'm going to have a center of gravity. Now this diagram will make things a lot clear for you. I'm having a continuous rigid body like a stone above. Okay, I'm telling this. Let us consider a stone like this. Stone or some iron piece, continuous body. Okay, now this is going there. Now solving a dynamic problem for such a continuous mass system is complicated, because you will have a n number of vectors. from all the point masses of the mass. I am doing in only one line. All the area points on the area will have one vector in particular direction. Now this becomes extremely difficult to do the calculation, finding the result. So then what I am going to do, I am going to replace this with two individual masses, okay, separated by two distances. Now when the three conditions mentioned above are met in the last slide, when the three conditions mentioned in the last slide are met, then this entire stone can be replaced by these two small point masses placed. Now this is your, the center of gravity, cumulative center of gravity of M1, M2 should coincide here. The same center of gravity point. Okay. So from this point, I have some L1 distance M1, L2 distance M2. Okay. So then this L1 plus L2 equal to capital L. Then this thing, so this will not be there. Okay. This is given for your simple representation. This thing is said to be dynamically equivalent to this body if the above three conditions are met. Okay, now let us see those three conditions mathematically. First condition, let M equal to mass of the rigid body. What is the first condition? Radius of variation of the rigid body is given by K suffix capital G. That is the initial radius of variation. Okay, so M1 and M2 are the two masses of the dynamically equivalent system, small masses that I am going to replace the rigid body. Okay. L1 distance of the mass M1 from center of gravity, the small mass M1 is placed at a distance of L1 from the center of gravity. The center of gravity is extended, there is no change in center of gravity. From the center of gravity, the small mass M1 point mass is placed at a distance of L1. Similarly, L2, this second small mass M2 point mass M2 is placed at a distance of L2 from the center of gravity. Okay. So let L1 plus L2 equal to capital L, total distance between the masses M1 and M2. This capital L is nothing but, you can see the diagram very easily, you can understand. L1 plus L2 equal to capital L is nothing but the distance between the centers of the point masses M1 and M2. Capital L. Okay. These are the fundamental assumptions. Okay, now some of their masses, the first point, I am going to repeat the three points, then we are going to see it mathematically. Very simple. Okay. It's not complicated. Very simple. So first rule, some of their masses should be equal. M1 plus M2 should be equal to the rigid body mass. Second point, center of gravity of the two masses must coincide. Third point, some of the mass moment of inertia of masses about their individual center of gravity should be equal to the mass moment of inertia of the rigid body. These are the three points. Okay. So thus these assumptions above mentioned three conditions for dynamically equivalent system. So first condition, very, very simple, mathematically representing the sum of their masses is equal to the total mass of the rigid body. M1 plus M2 equal to M. Okay. So the, let us say that big stone represented in the diagram, this stone has a mass of M. Now I am replacing it with two masses, M1 and M2. When I add M1 and M2, I should get the capital small. When I add M1 and M2, I should get M. That is the first rule. This rule is met, okay, mathematically. Next. Second condition, center of gravity of the two masses must coincide. What does this mean? How do you represent it in mathematical form? I am going to take moment about the center of gravity, M1, L1, M2, L2. Okay, let us go by.
Sir, I can't able to hear, sir. You are not audible to me.
Does anybody else ask this problem? Am I audible to everybody?
Sir, you are audible, sir.
Okay. To whom I am not audible? I didn't see you. Who is that?
I think
maybe you can leave the meeting and join again. I don't know whether you have any network. Okay, fine. We will continue. Let him join again. We will see whether the problem persists. Okay, first condition. Some of the masses must be equal. Very simple condition. M1 plus M2 equal to M. Second condition, center of gravity should be exactly at the same place. There should be no change. Now, this can be mathematically represented, right? I think in your 12th standard, you have done an experiment called principle of moments. I did it. I don't know whether you did it. I will tell you what is the experiment. You take a wooden scale, 1 meter long wooden scale, and you place it on a knife edge. Okay. The first case, we put two slotted weights, one at this end and one 100 gram here, 100 gram here. If both the masses are equal, then this knife edge can be placed exactly at the center. If this is 1 meter, then I can, this L is 1 meter, then I can put this at 50 centimeter mark, the scale will balance. Okay, the next thing what I do is I'm going to increase this to 200 gram. Then what I will do, I will move the scale a little bit far, a little bit closer in this side. Okay, 200 grams. I put it, put the scale somewhere at 30 centimeter. Here the same 100 gram is maintained. When the moment in the two sides are equal, mass into perpendicular distance. So 30 centimeter into some weight equal to 70 centimeter into some weight. If they are equal, then the scale will again balance. The masses need not be equal. So that is called the principle of momentum. Okay. So this experiment, I think most of you would have done in your school. I don't know what you have studied because it has been so long since I completed my school. I don't know whether this was in your school. What does this experiment tell you? If a larger load can be placed closer to the center of gravity, a smaller load when kept far away, the moment is determining whether the balance is obtained or not. What is moment? Mass into this distance. The moment is equal, the scale will balance. It doesn't have to be necessary that both the masses should be equal. So what is the first, then by this rule, what is the first requirement for a physical balance when I'm going to buy vegetables? If this fulcrum is exactly at the center, then only the mass on this side will be equal to the mass on this side. If I want to cheat people, what I can do, I can put it a little bit this side. Then what will happen? Or this side. Then the balance will not be obtained for equal mass. You have to calculate the moment and see what will happen, which is the easy way to offset the masses, right? That is there, M1L1, M2L2. If they balance each other, then the center of gravity will remain at the same place. That is the second mathematical condition. Third mathematical condition. The sum of the moment of inertias, when an individual moment of inertias about their individual center of gravities, when I add them, I should get the moment of inertia of the initial body. Okay. So M1 L1 square plus M2 L2 square equal to M kg square. Okay. So here, you have to understand this L1 and L2 are representing, again in turn, they are also representing the individual radius of gyrations of the individual bodies about their center of gravity, cumulative center of gravity also. Okay, do you understand? When mass M1 is placed at some distance, now this is L1, L2. So it means the cumulative center of gravity only, right? Rotation is going to take place about this center only. Okay, let us assume a connecting rod. We're going to do problems on connecting rods only. So to do a kinematic analysis or a dynamic analysis of a connecting rod, it is very complicated to consider the entire object and forces acting. Instead of that, I'm going to place two masses at the ends, separated by some distance. This distance, this distance we are going to calculate. Two masses and then place them particular this value of M1, M2, L1, L2 are adjusted so that this is going to exactly behave as a connecting rod. It is possible. Okay, so that is the general idea. So now M1, L1, L1 is nothing but the radius of gyration of this mass about the cumulative center of gravity. I think I mentioned it wrongly earlier. It is about the cumulative center of gravity only. Okay, M2, L2 square. This is the radius of gyration of this mass. What does the radius of gyration tell you? The rotation takes place about from the center at that some distance, some radius. Okay, when you are in rotations, distance from the center is also called as radius. So it should be equal to m kg square. What is kg? Kg is the radius of gyration of the rigid body that I already declared in the beginning. So that is the third rule. When these three rules are met, then the rigid body can be effectively replaced by the two mass system. So your work is to find m1 l1 m2 l2 that can effectively replace this connecting rod with these two mass system. That is the general idea of the problem, dynamically influenced. That's what we are going to do. Okay. What is equation 1.18? Considering M1, L1 equal to M2, now we are going to derive some, using these three mathematical relationships, I am going to derive some formulas for easy usage in the problem. I don't have to again and again go back to the fundamentals where I am doing the problem. I'm going to take these three equations. First, I am taking this equation m1 alone equal to m2 l2. I'm going to find out some relationship. So considering equation 1.18, m1 alone equal to m2 l2. So that is equation 1.18. This can be written so mathematically. So m1 equal to m2 l2 by l1. Just a cross multiply. Send this l1 to the denominator. Similarly, the other case also can be written. M2 equal to. So what does this tell you? If you know any three, the fourth can be found out. Let us say I know l1, m2, l2. Then I can find out m1. Or if I know m1, l1 and l2, I can find out m2. That is the basic idea. That's what these two things tell you. So m1 equal to m2 l2 by l1, m2 equal to m1 l1 by l2. Simple cross multiplication. This is the converse of this. First one is converse of this. This is also correct. And this is also correct mathematically. Okay. So put these two expressions into equation 1.17. What is equation 1.17? M1 plus M2 equal to M. That is equation 1.1. First equation. M1 plus M2 equal to M. Why am I putting this number 1.17? Why not 1, 2, 3? Because this is a continuation of your workbook. Whatever numbers I have followed in your workbook, the same numbers I am using in the PPT. So it will be easy for you to follow. I don't know how many of you have taken the printout of your workbook. If it is with you, it will be very simple for you to follow. All these derivations are given in your workbook. So M is equal to. So in place of M1, I am going to put this. Okay, in place of M2, I'm going to put this. So M1 plus M2. That is M2 L2 by L1 plus M1 L1 by L2. Okay. So I'm going to take common factor outside M1 L1 into 1 by L1 plus 1 by L1. How is this possible? So here you have M2. Here you have M1. But I have taken M1 L1 common outside and I'm putting 1 in both the numerators. So it is based on the underlying fact that M1 L1 equal to M2 L2. This we know already. This is where you have begun. Okay. So when I'm taking the common factor M1 L1 outside, I know that these two things are equal. That is how I am putting 1 here. Otherwise, what I should put here? M2 by M1 I have to put here. But I know that they are equal. That is how I am deliberately taking M1 L1 common term outside and I am putting 1 here. Even though I don't have M1 here, I know that these two things are equal. That's how I am able to simply put 1 here. Okay, please remember that. This you may not understand when you directly look into the book. A little bit misleading. So I take M1 L1 outside, 1 by L1 plus 1 by L2. Or you can do the opposite also. You can take M2 L2 outside and put 1 plus 1 by L1 plus L2. Do you understand this or not? So I'm taking M1 L1 outside, 1 by L1 plus 1 by L2. So from here, I am moving on. Take LCM, L1 inside the bracket, take LCM, L1, L2, numerator you have L1 plus L2. Okay. Similarly, this side take LCM, M2, L2 equal to, inside the bracket take denominator L1 into L2, numerator you have L1 plus L2. Take LCM and add inside the bracket. Okay. Then what will happen? I can strike out these two things. Because they are in multiplication. You should not strike out this because it is an addition, the numerator. You can strike this. Okay. L1.
in some network problem, and that can save. I'll repeat from the beginning of the slide. I think we have seen up to this. I don't know when I got cut off. Okay, I was talking continuously. So what I am doing, from the previous slide, I know I have taken M1 L1 as common outside. So since M2 L2 equal to M1 L1, I am putting one here. The same place. This already was M1 L1, so one here. Similarly, this side. I hope you are able to follow up to this. Any doubts, you can open the mic and ask me. Okay. So now M1 L1, I am going to take LCM of these two things and add it. So L1 L2 will be the LCM. So the numerator here will get L2, here will get L1. So this can be rearranged and written as L1 plus L2 divided by L1 L2. Similarly, this side, same thing. The bracket inside the bracket term will be the same. Same thing, you take LCM here and add L1 plus L2 by L1 L2. Now I can strike this out. Okay, so that is the next step. So effectively, you are getting a formula for mass equal to M1 into L1 plus L2 by L2. Similarly, this side, mass equal to M2 into L2 by L1 plus L2 by L1. Now, you have to think about one thing. For any logical given problem, this will be given to you. Some big rigid body, some connecting rod of mass, 20 kg, 30 kg, should be replaced with two different masses placed at two different distances. That is a logical problem for you solving in this topic. So the formula should be derived for M1 and M2, not for M, because M will be given to you. M1 and M2 are the unknown quantities. So what you do, you cross multiply. Send these two things this side. Similarly, send this to the denominator left side, numerator left side. So that will give you the formula for M1 and M2. Okay. So M1 equal to mass into L2 by L1 plus L2. Equation 1.20, I'm keeping it as. Similarly, M2 equal to M1, just cross multiplying M2 M into L1 by L1 plus L2. Okay, so the easy way to remember this formula for your exam, if you have 1 year, you will have 2 here. If you have 2 here, you will have 1 year. All the other terms remain same, M by L1 plus L2, M by L1 plus L2. So if you are finding for first mass, put second length year. If you are finding second mass, put first length year. That is the easy way to remember the formula. Okay, so this I am keeping it as equation 1.21. So M1, I'm rewriting the equations. So substitute equation 1.20 and 1.21 in 1.19. What is 1.19? The sum of the moment of inertia should be equal to the initial moment of inertia. So in that formula, I'm going to put these mass equations. Okay. So in place of M1, put this entire thing. M1. So why we are doing all this is to derive some formula for easy solution of problems. In place of M2, you put here M1, M2. In place of M1, I am going to write this. In place of M2, I am going to write this in this equation. Okay. So look here, M1, L1 square, M2, L2 square. This looks like I, but this is L. Okay. When you type capital small L and capital I, looks the same in a computer. This is actually L. Okay. So M into L is I. It should be only 1 equal to. There is a mistake here. And when I am posting the detail, they will correct it. So divide the entire above equation by M. So I am going to eliminate M. Since I have M in all the three terms, eliminate M. So this will go. All the three M's will vanish. So L1 by L1 plus L2 into L1 square. L1 by L1 plus L2, L2 by L1, L2 by L1 plus L2, L1 square. L1 by L1 plus L2, L2 square equal to kg square. So now I can do some manipulation. Since both the denominators are the same, I can club the fraction L2 L1 square plus L1 L2 square. So easily you can understand one thing. I can factorize this numerator now. Okay. I'm going to try to factorize this numerator L2 into L1 square. I can take L1 L2 common as outside in these terms, right? It's very easy. So take L1 and L2 as common outside, then you will leave with L1 plus L2. If I take L1 L2 outside in the first term, I'll have one extra L1 because you have a square here. Similarly, here one extra L2 will be here. So L1 into L2 multiplied by L1 plus L2 equal to kg square. Now you can cancel this.
So therefore, L1 L2 equal to kg square. When you multiply the distances, you will have L1 L2 equal to kg square. Okay. So that I am going to keep as equation 1.22. So equation 1.22 is the essential condition to obtain a dynamically influenced system. Very, very simple. If you know the radius of gyration of your rigid body, you can check whether your L1 and L2 are correct. You multiply the two distances L1 and L2, that should be the square of the radius of gyration of the initial body. The distance of one of the masses is arbitrarily chosen. Second mass distance can be obtained from the above equation 1.22. Okay, so I'm going to assume what adjust the second distance with respect to this equation. Then my system will be dynamically equivalent. Okay, you will understand this completely when you are doing a problem. Don't worry. So if you can assume L1, I know kg, I can find L2. That's what I'm trying to say. Okay. So when the radius of gyration is not known, the position of the second mass may be obtained by considering the body as a compound pendulum. So this will give you some additional formulas. Length of a simple pendulum which gives the same frequency as a rigid body is given. Okay, let us, why we are considering a pendulum into this, I'll explain. We are going to consider a connecting rod. Okay. So I'm trying to draw with a mouse, so please. It will be very approximate. So connecting some connecting rod. Okay. So now what is the motion of the connecting rod? How does the motion of the connecting rod resemble? So initially the connecting rod is here vertical, when the piston is up, the piston will be like this. Okay. The piston is at 3 dc. When the piston starts moving down, connecting rod will get inclined. At one point, your connecting rod maximum amplitude to the left side will be like here. Right. But this position will not be here, it will be somewhere here. It will move. Let's forget this up and down motion. Let's only concentrate on the left right motion. Similarly, on the other end of the stroke, motion is assumed to be a pendulum. Okay. Since this end is not fixed, it is moving. I'm going to consider the formula of a compound pendulum, not a pendulum. Okay. So can people hear me?
I don't know, some network problem.
Okay, 1 minute. Okay, I will take back. So, sorry for the disturbance. Some network problem here. Raja sir.
Sir,
how long I was outside? How long sir? It has been? How long it has been hanging for? Evlo nerama hang aachu screen?
1 minute.
The pendulum drop pannilla. Pendulum drop pannu therinjada? I'll repeat the pendulum. Okay, no problem. I'll repeat the pendulum. See, now what we are going to do? Length of the connecting rod is now I am going to assume it to be a pendulum. Why pendulum? That's what I was trying to explain when it got hanged. So I am having a connecting rod like this. Okay, an approximate connecting rod. Now you imagine what is the movement of a connecting rod. The piston is here. Okay, the piston is moving up and down, reciprocating. So the connecting rod, forget that this gudgeon is going to move up and down. Let us consider only the oscillating component of motion of the connecting rod. It will go up to here to some extreme position when the theta is 90 degree. And when the theta is 270 degree, the connecting rod will, this big end of the connecting rod will be, and the crankshaft will be here like this. Right. Now that tells you If you ignore this motion of this point and consider it, consider only the y component of motion, forgetting the x component, if this is x and this is y, or any polar coordinates, whatever, okay. If I consider only this component of motion, ignoring the x motion, then you will understand that the connecting rod is behaving like a pendulum. Right? You are having an oscillatory motion. Now, since this point is not fixed, I am going to consider it as a compound pendulum. Okay. So, we will see what is a compound pendulum later. Don't worry about it. So, the formula for a compound pendulum, L equal to ag square plus h square by h. What is h? Is the length of the string. This is h. For any given pendulum, okay, up to the center of the bar. Now that h is taken. Kg square plus h square by h is the formula for pendulum. Okay, replacing by h by L1 in the above equation, so compound pendulum will have more than one center of gravity. So that's why you are taking center, compound pendulum. A simple pendulum is what you have studied in your school. That will have only one center of gravity. Compound pendulum will have more than one center of gravity. I think some CBSE people might have studied the compound pendulum in their school. Okay, you just remember this formula, very simple. L is equal to, in place of h, I am putting L1. Okay, in the above expression. Substitute equation 1.22 into the above equation. What is equation 2? 1.22. L1, L2 equal to kg square. Okay, so L1, L2, L is equal to, this equation I have already known. In place of kg, I am going to put L1 plus L2 in. In this equation, in place of this kg, I am going to write L1, L2 inside the bracket. In place of kg, write L1, L2 whole square. Okay. So L1, L2, not whole square. Kg square equal to L1, L2. That is the equation. Correct? Whole square will not work. In place of entire kg square here, write L1, L2. No square will come. Square will vanish. So L1, L2. L1, L2. Instead of this kg plus L1 square divided by L1, same equation. Okay, so now L1, L2, I'm going to split the fraction, the same fraction, you split it and write this has one fraction and this has the other fraction. Okay, L1, L2 by L1 plus L1 square by L1, this I can cancel, right? And this I can cancel, which is nothing but L1 plus L2. Okay, so what does this mean to you? Capital L is nothing but L1 plus L2, right? So initially we have told that this that I am proving. This means that the second mass is to be situated at the center of oscillation or percussion of the body, which is at a distance of L2, kg square by L1. So L1 plus L2 equal to kg square. Therefore, if you know one of the length, you can find the other length by dividing it from the square of the radius of variation. Okay. So out of these all the conditions, it may seem that you have not fully understood this. Don't worry. The concept is we are going to replace connecting rod with two masses. That is the thing. Okay. So some formula. Moment of inertia I equal to mk square. General formula. For in that k square position, you can put either L1 for mass M1, L2 for mass M2, kg for the rigid body mass. All formula are same for inertia. I equal to mk square. Okay. For dynamical equilibrium system, L1 into L2 equal to k condition. Only then your system will be dynamically equivalent. Magnitude of the equivalent mass is M1 equal to M into L2 by L1 plus L2. M2 equal to M into L1 by L1 plus L2. This we have derived already. So simple shortcut to remember this. So if you have M1 here, put L2 here. If you have M2 here, put L1 here. All the other things remain same. M by L1 plus L2. That's what I have told you earlier. Okay. Fourth formula, the value of radius of gyration is unknown. The value of radius of gyration is unknown, then I am going to use the pendulum formula. Okay, kg square L1 plus L2, capital L equal to L1 plus L2. Time period of oscillation of a simple, this is from physics book, general. This has nothing to do with dynamics. Okay, time period of oscillation, 2 pi by L1 by g, root square root. This again, for two different pendulums. So L1 equal to length of the equivalent simple pendulum and suspended from top of the small end bearing. L2 is length of this equal pendulum suspended from the top end of the big end of the bearing. Two cases are given. When you are doing the problem, you will understand this. Okay. So general formula, time period of oscillation 2 pi into L by G square root. That whether you are going to put L1 or L2 depends on the question. When you have to choose L1, when my known distances from the small end of the bearing, whether L1 will be given or L2 will be given in the question. If L1 is given, small end bearing distance is given, a distance of one of the masses from the small end of the bearing is given, then you have to choose this formula. Big end bearing distance is given, this formula you have to choose. I think you know what is small end and big end. The end of the connecting rod which is connected to the piston is called small end. That which is connected to the crankshaft is called big end. Okay, this you should be knowing already. The last formula, time period of oscillation of a simple pendulum where 2 pi, this is another general formula, 2 pi into root of kg square plus h square by gh. Keep all these things in your mind. Now we will do some. This is